Amen. Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Isaiah, chapter number 28. Isaiah, chapter number 28. Praise the Lord. Just keep in mind, Sister Stacy is released from the hospital. Let's keep her in prayer. If you're able to do something for her, I'm not sure all of her dietary situation is there. If you want to do something, certainly let's think about that and keep her in prayer. We miss her when she's not here. Praise God. Isaiah chapter 28, look at verse number 13. The Bible says, "But the word of the Lord was unto them precept upon precept. Precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line. Here a little and there a little, that they may go and fall backward and be broken, snared and taken. Wherefore hear the word of the Lord, ye scornful men, that rule this people which is in Jerusalem. Because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death, and how are we at agreement? And hell we are at agreement. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, it shall not come unto us, for we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves." Wow, what a crazy place to be. Listen, we have made a covenant with death, and with hell we are at agreement. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, it shall not come unto us, for we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves. Think about that this morning, having made a covenant with death, an agreement with hell, hiding ourselves under a refuge of lies, and under falsehood that we hid ourselves. I don't want to be there.
Amen.
Where hell is, where lies are a refuge. Some people, their life is built upon lie, upon lie, upon lie. They don't even know where to stop. Now they find a refuge in lie. Hid under falsehood, where there is an agreement made with hell and a covenant with death. I don't want to be there. May my covenant be made with God and His righteousness. May my life be lived in the light of His truth. I want to talk about an agreement made with hell. A covenant that's formed. A truce that's made with hell. I'm afraid that so many live their life having an agreement made with hell. I want to ask us this morning, where has hell gone? Where has hell gone? Those of us that we meet throughout our week, whether it's by job or however it may be, there's a lot of folks who don't believe in a literal hell. Where has hell gone? Some folks have said that I've gone to church for years and years and never heard a message preached on hell. Sad. And I think even myself, have I preached enough upon hell? Enough messages about hell? And some folks will say, well, this world's the only hell that we'll ever know. Well, for the Christian, that's yes. But for those who don't know Jesus as their Savior, this is the only heaven that they'll know. Think about the trials of this life and the test and sometimes the difficulty, but this will be the only heaven some folks will even know. And thinking about hell, a gentleman wrote this. He said that at some point in the 1960s, that hell disappeared. And at the disappearance of hell, if we felt like we didn't have to preach upon hell, there was a great relief that was gone. But I need to tell you that if we don't face the reality of hell, we will have a multitude of problems that we do not want to have to face. Amen. Hell's a real place this morning. It is increasing. think, oh, God, help us to realize that there is a hell this morning that is a reality, and each of us need to face the reality of hell. One person said it this way, that hell may be under fire this morning, but though it is under fire by popular opinion, it has not decreased the eternal flames of hell. Hell. Some people use it just in passing. You probably, some of you have probably heard it from coworkers this week. Maybe somewhere in your walking, somebody has taken hell just as by name. What the? Maybe someone got mad at someone else in anger. They said, well, they can just go to hell. People say it so quickly and so abruptly without ever knowing what they are saying. Hell is real this morning.
Amen.
Hell is a terrible place. And as we look at hell this morning, there's something that very few people begin to realize, that beyond the grave, there is either a heaven or there is a hell. But hell is real. The Bible says this, that its flames cannot be quenched, that it is a burning place, that it is outer darkness, it is a place where there is gnashing of teeth, there is a place where our memory is working against us, it is a place not to party. Someone will say, well, I'll just go to hell and party with my friends. There is no party in hell. There is an eternal death in hell, and that's all that those that go to will face for an eternity, is an everlasting death. God help us this morning to realize that there is a hell that is to be shunned. There's a heaven to be gained. Amen. As much as there is a reality of heaven, there is a reality of hell. Amen. Everybody thinks that if you live a good life, then you're going to go to heaven. No, you can live a good life and go to hell. It takes the blood of Jesus. Amen. It takes a life dedicated to Him to send you to heaven. Without the blood of Jesus, souls will die and go to hell. Places this morning, heaven or hell. And I need to tell you that I believe that there's been an agreement, there's been a pact, there's been a truth that has been made with hell, that if we can do away with the reality of it all, amen, that we'll be in a better place. And it's not a new thought, it's not a new story. In fact, you go back 750 years B.C., right here where the prophet Isaiah was, this is the place that they are at. They made an agreement with hell. We don't believe in hell. We don't think it's that bad. We made an agreement with hell. So 2,765 years ago, it was no different than it is today. Wow, that's traveling back a ways. We'll make a pact with hell. We'll make an agreement with hell. And so here we find that there was a reformation back in Isaiah's day that was made by Hezekiah. And so it was only half-hearted. Hezekiah destroyed idols, and he went into the groves, and he cleansed the groves, and those places of high worship, of idolatry, he got rid of. But it was only a partial revival. The problem was how Hezekiah needed to deal with a moral problem that was happening in his day and hour. There's moral decay in the day and hour in which we live. Yesterday morning I was praying, I was thinking about this, I had to say this. But you know, I know that there's a problem with killing, I know there's a problem with guns. I don't want to upset anybody's apple cart here this morning. I grew up in a house where there was guns. Yeah, we would target shoot. We'd shoot tin cans off the fence post. That was a lot of fun for us and our family. But you know what? There was never a time where I thought about taking that gun and hurting someone with it. I think our problem of moral decay comes greatly not because of a gun, but because of the moral value of our society. I think if anything needs an overhaul, how about we look at Hollywood? Come on, Brother Snow. We sit and entertain ourselves They entertain themselves all day long with killings, murder, violence. That is the entertainment, and we think that it doesn't affect a society in which we live. There's a problem with the moral decay of our society. And then Hollywood will go on to say that there is not a literal reality of hell. There is a problem in our society. God help us to realize that we need to cleanse our society, that there's lots of idols and there's high places of worship that need to come down, but we need to deal with the moral problem in society, and it needs to start right here in the church. And so here it is, Hezekiah's dealing with the moral problem of society, and he cleanses the temple of idolatry worship. He goes to the groves. But what did Jesus say? Jesus said this, that when you cleanse the house, that you have to fill it with righteousness, or else those evil things that you've gotten rid of, they'll come back seven times worse. And so what do we need to do in our life? Fill it with the righteousness of God. God, help us this morning to get rid of moral decay. God, help us this morning to get rid of idolatry and those things that raise themselves up higher than God. And as we cleanse it, God, help us to fill it with righteousness. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Brother, sister, I want to tell you, God wants us to cleanse our life from unrighteousness. God wants us to tear down anything that exalts itself higher than God. Whatever that is in our lives, every one of us, amen, it will be a daily struggle to keep our hearts where they need to be with God. Amen. It is looking at our hearts. It's making sure things are right every day. And then when we destroy those things, we fill it with righteousness. Amen. You know why? Because if we're not careful, we'll forget that there is a literal hell that is awaiting for those who do not live righteously. Isaiah was probably a small boy when Amos appeared on the scene preaching the gospel. He was probably a boy when the prophet Hosea lived out his life with his wife Gomer. He was probably a small boy and saw that. And then he probably was a contemporary with Micah the prophet. And so here it is that Isaiah picks up in these words. He said, "Woe unto him that crowns himself with pride, the drunkenness of Ephraim." He says, the beauty is like a flower that's fading. But all the word of God we need it. He talks about the error of their vision and that they stumble and that judgment is a hell. He talks about there being a covenant with death and a covenant with hell. And he talks about hiding themselves in falsehood. God, help us this morning. Amen. I don't want to make a truce with hell. Hell is real this morning. Amen. I want to look at a couple people, just two people this morning, who I believe that they made a truce with hell. And if we're not careful, we can fall into the same situation in which they were in. When I look at the men of Isaiah's day making a truce with hell, forgetting that there was coming a day where they were going to have to settle up for all of life's events. Amen. There's coming a payday. I said this morning that there's coming a day where we will rest from our labors. Amen. And if we live faithful, God is going to say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." I need to tell you something that men of Isaiah's day and men of our day seem not to have an inclination that there is coming a day where we will settle up about the score of life with God Almighty. Amen. And if we do not live life righteously, amen, we will not go to that place that God has prepared for those who love Him and expect His return. Amen. But we will die and go to a devil's hell, even though we attended church. Even for us as believers, if we're not careful, the reality of hell can cease. So, when we look at what Jesus said, it's an interesting thought. Jesus told a parable in Matthew chapter number 25. He told a parable about some servants. And the Bible says in Matthew 25, I'm going to read just verse 24 and 25. We'll talk about the preceding verses in a moment. But the Bible says, then he which had received one talent came and said, Lord, Lord, I knew that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast it. That is thine. You may say, Brother Bill, how is this all going to tie in? Hold on for a moment. I'm going to show you. If we're not careful, we can make a truce with hell by beginning to make some rationalizations that are totally off the wall. So here the Bible is talking about a servant, and he comes to three of his masters. And Brother Joshua, the first servant, he gives 5 talents. Brother Justin, to the second servant, he gives 2 talents. And Brother Rick, to the third servant, he gives 1 talent. Now that may seem unfair in some ways. And so let's look at this guy who receives 1 talent. I believe he made a truce with hell. I believe that somewhere in the middle he forgot about the God he was serving and the importance of being faithful to God, even in the little things. Here it was, I believe that this man began to get upset about the conditions. He looked and he said, man, I only have 1 talent. 1 talent, 1 little piece of money. That's all I have. God, the master, gave the other one 2 pieces and the other one 3 pieces. And he began to let a grain on him, get upset. If we're not careful, we can begin to let the situations of our life begin to grate upon us. Why didn't I get what someone else did? My talents seem so few. Why did my pathway lead me here? If I were to ask every one of you in a personal spot this morning, is there anywhere in life that you've been disappointed? I guarantee you that every one of you would say, yes, I am very disappointed that life turned out this way. It wasn't your expectancy. It wasn't what you even expected from God. But I want to tell you that when God hands you 1 talent, God wants you to be faithful with 1 talent. If you're not careful, you can become frustrated with the life that you've been given and not live it in the light of eternity and not be faithful with what God has given you and die and end up in a devil's hell because you've not been faithful with what God has given. So here is this man with 1 talent. He's mulling over in his mind these thoughts. He's thinking life is not fair. He's thinking, I've got a short exchange for this whole affair. My contribution is so small. What does it matter what I do with this little bit of money? I'm as good as the next man. Why wasn't I esteemed with more? Maybe he thought, so low. Why am I the one being passed over for the promotion? Why didn't I get more? We've all been there. Come on. Come on. Supposed to be up, you're right. Amen. I've been there. I feel like I'm the guy with a little bit. And so his realization led him farther and farther and farther away from what the master wanted him to do. The master didn't ask him to make as much as the first guy or the second guy. The master wanted him to be faithful with what he was given and taking what he had and utilize it. Amen. God knows exactly what each one of us has, and God wants us to utilize what he has given to us. And so his deadly realizations led him down a path, amen, that he made a truce or an agreement with hell. He wasn't faithful with what he was given. He just said, it's frustrating. I give up. How many people are here in the sanctuary this morning that maybe you knew 1 time served God because of life hasn't gone the way that they wanted it to? Somehow they got their eyes off of God. They got their eyes off the mark. They forgot that what God has given them, they have a responsibility to tending to and being faithful to it. So they got their eyes off God. The problem with the church is this, that some people think that they're too big to do something small, when in reality, they're too small to do something big. God wants you to be faithful with what he's given to you. Or else, you could be in a very uncomfortable place that you sign a truce with hell. I'll sign on the dotted line. God has forgotten about me. And we sign a truce. We give up being faithful. We give up fighting for eternity. We give up the spiritual things in which God has given to us. Amen. God wants us to be faithful. I want to say to you this morning, don't waste your talent. Don't waste your life. Don't bury your desire for God. Don't let the truth put truth on hell. Don't even hide your sin, but be transparent with God. Say, God, I want to be faithful in what I have. God wants you to be faithful. Because I think it's interesting that God wrote in chronological order the book of Job first. Here's Job going through all these trials. In the middle of all these trials, he shows us something. We can't lose sight of eternity. I know that my Redeemer lives, and I shall stand with him. I'm looking beyond this present moment, and I'm looking into eternity. I talked with a friend this weekend. He was sharing with me a tremendous loss that he had in his life. Such a great loss. And he said, my family said, how can you serve that God you serve because of the loss that you have? He said, I didn't look at the contract and see that the expiration date was so soon. He said, God only loaned me these things. God only loaned me these things. And I was faithful as God loaned them to me. So I'll keep being faithful. Listen, no matter what our losses, no matter what our gains, no matter where we're at in life, we've got to be faithful to God. We don't know when the contract expires for the things in our life, for the things that God has blessed us with. But we just got to be faithful. Don't lose sight of eternity. Don't sign an agreement with hell that makes you forget about spiritual things and their importance. So if we're not careful, we'll rationalize life out in our own mind and sign an agreement with hell and forget about the importance of living and being faithful with what we have until eternity. In Luke chapter 16, we read another story. The Bible talks about a rich man and a beggar named Lazarus. Several things about the story. We certainly see that the rich man, and in hell he lifted up his eyes. The Bible says he died and he went to hell. The beggar died. Lazarus died. The beggar died. The Bible says the facts about Lazarus is in hell. He lifted up his eyes. The beggar, he went into Abraham's bosom, or what we know now as heaven. And so here it is that Lazarus, there's a few things that I recognize about this rich man. First of all, they brought the beggar there, Brother Rick, so there was a reason why they brought the beggar to the rich man's door, Brother Terry, every day. Because the rich man did take care of him. He gave him food, Bobby. He was faithful in feeding him. There was a reason why. He was a good man. And he must have been a hard worker because of things that he had accumulated in life. But the problem was this. Not that he was a terrible man, because I believe he was a good man, this Lazarus, this rich man. I believe he was a very good man. Because the Bible speaks that he did good. He did good things. But the problem was he got caught up by the collar and living life. He got caught up by the label of having the best and achieving. He ultimately gave up some things that were important. He gained all the things that he could in this life, but he gave up the things for the life to come. If we're not careful, we can get so busy in acquiring, needing this job and this vehicle and this house and this land, taking this vacation and that vacation and storing up for our retirement. We can get so busy in the everyday affairs of this life that we can forget about eternity. You may say, but Seville, I do good to others. I help folks out. I give them a lending hand. If I see someone in need, I give them some money. If I see someone need some food, I give them some food. I try to do good. But if you're not careful, you can be caught up in all the good and forget about eternity. You see, because what happened with this rich man was this. With the rich man, the beggar Lazarus. See, we find that the greatest of all being is heaven. And the greatest of all losses is our soul. The greatest of all gain is heaven. And the greatest of all losses is our soul. And the rich man, he got all mixed up. He was trying to gain. But he didn't try to gain heaven. And he lost his own soul. I don't want you to fall out with me here. I'm going to be honest, okay? That's when folks say, Pastor, I just can't make it to church. I'm too tired. Pastor, I just have too much going on. They said they have too much. Because the greatest game you can make is heaven. What cost me too much to be in church, Brother Seville? Wait a second, it cost you too much not to be in church. But so I might lose this job opportunity. I might lose some time of socialization with my family. But the greatest of all losses is our soul. Don't make a truce with hell. Eternity is too long to be wrong. You may say, I'm angry with God, I have so little. Listen, take what you have and be faithful to God. This morning you may just have your priorities all wrong. I want to tell you that your priorities can be so wrong that you can die and go to the devil's hell no matter how good you are. You can take care of Lazarus. But if you're not taking care of your soul, then you've lost all. I read a story not too long ago about Eli Whistle. Eli Whistle tells the story of how that he lived in Tanzania, I believe it was, which was hungry at the time. He was a Jew, and he was being put on a train with his mom and his dad and his sister. And they were being taken because of being Jewish. Being Jewish, they were being taken by Hitler. And as they were traveling on the train, he said, I never knew that in my travel I would be the only one to live. My mom and my sister would be burnt to death. My dad would die of dysentery. I would be the only one to survive. He said, I remember being on the train, and as I was on the train, he said, I was with several people. He said, some of them I knew. He said, some of their family had already been broken up. He said, and I remember Madame Aswatzer, as she was there on the train with us. Her husband wasn't with her. They had been separated, and she was only with one son of hers. He said, I remember how they were our neighbors, and we would go and we would visit them. They were wonderful people. Her husband was a hard worker. He was studying many, many days. He said, as we were making our commute there on that cattle train, he said, she was so broken. She was just in hysterics, and she just almost seemed like she'd gone over the edge because of the brokenness of her family and being taken and not knowing where she was going to go. He said, before we got on that cattle car, there was 80 of us, and they told us to give our money. If we had gold, if we had silver, we were to empty our pockets, and we were to give it to them. And if we were caught hiding anything, that we would be killed. They told us that they had us numbered, that there was 80 of us, and if the number changed, that they would begin to kill people till they found out who was missing. He said, as we were making our commute day and night, he said, one night he said, Madame Schwarzer got up in the middle of the train, and she began to yell, fire! Fire! And she was gazing out the window. He said, I was awoken from my sleep. My mom and my dad were there, and he said, we got up and we looked out the window, and there wasn't any fire, but she would particularly look to one spot, and she would point and yell, fire! He said, the hours would pass, a couple days would pass, as we were traveling in the train, and she would look at that same spot, and she would say, fire! Fire! And they would tell her to sit down and to be quiet because there was no sound of fire. He said, I remember looking over and seeing her son rubbing her hand as she was in hysterics over this fire, as she was staring at one place. He said, finally, we got to that place where the train was slowing down. He said, we saw the blaze of fire, and we felt the stench of burning flesh. He said so many did not believe there was fire because they could not see. But when they saw the fire and believed and tried to mourn. Preachers preach the message that there's a day when fire is